thanks very much for turning out tonight for this one, considering that there is a bit of an alternative on top of the tour tonight. And being as you are all of the mature generation that was raised on weird pastimes like reading lots of books and digesting lots of information, you hopefully won't be too averse to a tremendous amount of stuff that I'm hoping that I can communicate tonight. Some of you have heard me talk on this subject before. I've done stuff at Magic about the Britain literally for 20 years in this town, on and off. I've also done a presentation for the Avalonians and the Arius Sophists. For those that have heard me before, I wanted to make sure that I brought in some fresh material. And if you have heard me before on these subjects, I'm going to be bringing up stuff that I don't think you would have ever presented in quite this way before. And lots of people have talked about 1940 and the magical working. So once again, it's really a case of, although that's the centre of gravity, it's going back. It's going back in time to see what the roots of these things were, that the whole thing did not come out of a vacuum, and it wasn't also just something that was part of that period of time. I first came to the subject of Nazi cultism right at the beginning of the 80s, and these are the kind of books that you would have read then. The Mourning of the Magicians and the Spear of Destiny. Heaven help you if you are still relying on those books as accurate sources of information. The Mourning of the Magicians is the book that launched all sorts of ideas like the 1,000 dead Tibetans in the ruins of Berlin, House Hofer as the great adept of the Thule Society behind Hitler and Hess. The man with the green gloves, this Tibetan magician, blah, 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 blah. It's all a load of complete rubbish. There's not a word of truth behind any of this material whatsoever. As for the Spear of Destiny, I can only say if Trevor Ravenscroft is still alive, even if he was a dribbling old man in a wheelchair, I would find him and I would shout at him quite a lot. The book is goddamn disgraced by any British standards. However, there's a certain ambience about it. It at least led me to interest in the work of Rudolf Steiner. And to try and research, you know, how much of this, the outrageous material in it actually was true. And I was led from things that most definitely were into some interesting realms. Since then, you know, a lot of useful material has come up. Now, I had an idea around about 2010, which was the time of the 70th anniversary of the Battle of Britain, which was when I commissioned Yuri to do this painting to my specifications of the contending forces and my idea of it. I started writing a book and I just had this idea on how I would handle it, because I had got this sense that there's a prehistory to all this that is potentially very interesting. I thought what I would do is I'd get a Microsoft Excel spreadsheet together and I'd have some columns for Glastonbury and some columns for Germany and some dates running across, and I'd reread the whole of the Avalonians by Patrick Benham, and I'd reread Nicholas Goodrich Clark's The Occult Roots of Nazism, which although it's 30 years old, is still really, you know, the definitive study from an academic point of view of all of this material. Still, if you want to go to one place to find out some accurate information rather than an internet full of gubbins about Nazi flying saucers from the Thule Society, then go to this book. I thought I'll read them one after the other, and I will just, anything that looks interesting, I'm just going to enter it in the columns, and then when I've done it, I'm going to read across the years and see what's happening compared to Glastonbury, Germany, people like Bly Bond, Wellesley Tudor Pole, Guido von List, Lance von Liebenfels. Does it all hang together? Is there anything interesting going on here? And I soon found out that there most definitely was. And it helped an awful lot that round about this time there was great new biographies of Bly Bond and Tudor Pole coming out, and Jerry Fenge's book only takes us so far into Tudor Pole's biography, and all the stuff about the Second World War and Silent Minute has yet to be published. And I'm very grateful to him because I corresponded with him at the time, and he very kindly sent me the material that he'd written, and he doesn't know when it's going to get published, on Tudor Pole in 1940 in the Silent Minute. And that is all incorporated into my work in progress, which I hope appears eventually. And we also had this fantastic study by Paul Ashdown of the whole story of Jesus being in Glastonbury. And it immediately became very interesting to me that the peak dissemination of this story was in the interwar years, you know, between 1920 and say 1940. The same period of time that the concept of the Aryan Christ is being propounded in Nazi Germany, or in Germany, in Nazi Germany. And I started to think to myself, and this is an idea that anybody that's familiar with Dion Fortune and her magic and her way of thinking would appreciate, that when in 1940 the visualisations began to feature Jesus as part of the imagery inside the hollow cavern of Glastonbury Tor, that whether anyone was even conscious of it or not, they were essentially bringing forth, you know, that Glastonbury version of Christ that was in the ethers, in the airwaves in 1940 and all the way from 1920. And that was a very interesting kind of balance against what was coming in from the opposite direction. Now, it's only in the last couple of years, it's amazing, until this, in 2012, Hammer of the Gods, there's not one single credible academic study of the Thule Society. There is so much stuff in the whole genre of Nazi occult literature, and it does pretty much start with the Morning of the Magicians. So much stuff all over the internet about the Thule Society, and it is quite astonishing what a total load of rubbish almost all of it actually is. But when you get to the real history, and they left a huge paper trail behind them, it's just nobody has had the sheer stamina to go into German archives and so on, ferret out all these magazines, look into it all. The history of it is quite extraordinary. There's no question in my mind that the Thule Society is the matrix of the Nazi Party. And when I started to weave together things, for example, that Wellesley Tudor Pole was doing, things that went on for decades, and things connected with the Thule Society and their roots, the people associated with them, it got very interesting, as I hope we'll see. It's back in 1993 when I was down in Glastonbury one weekend and I saw the Magical Battle of Britain in Gothic in the window. And I immediately thought, you know, I have to have this. What is this? What is this all about? I knew a little bit from biographies of Dion Fortune, like, say, Priestess by Adam Richardson, what had occurred in the war. But here we had a selection of her wartime letters collected by Gareth Knight. Now, Gareth Knight's remit was essentially just to present those letters, but what he also did was he just put in a few little notes here and there as the dates were being run down, and this was what was happening at the time. And as a total history nerd, somebody that's gone over the whole Dunkirk Battle of Britain Blitz thing about a zillion times ever since I was about 10, I got a just frustrated me a little bit that some of the little notes he put didn't quite do it for me. And I thought, I wonder what it would be like if you went through this stuff really slowly and you looked at how the war was developing in detail. Would you find anything interesting? That was what I started to do as I got into my more recent project. So we know the basics, that Dion Fortune had a group of people on a mailing list. I once corresponded with Adam Richardson about this. I said, did he know how many people were on that mailing list? He did, but he reckoned it wasn't more than about 100. It does look like some of them were not even in this country, but the vast majority were. And the idea was a letter went out And it was not to be opened until Sunday morning. It was called past 11, people would open the letters, and there was particular visualisation instructions in them that you would follow, and whatever at that, then you would write your little report and send it back to base, and then what then came back at you reflected that. And it starts off basically that they're in the London HQ of the Society of the Inner Light, and the idea of specific instruction is to focus on them there. And some imagery, very basic imagery of a rose cross, red rose and a cross of gold, or for people that really knew the Golden Dawn material, the incredibly detailed Golden Dawn rose cross with all the Hebrew letters and the astrological signs and all that stuff all over it. But most people are just looking at that. But it's only barely a couple of weeks into this that one of the people just find themselves, while they're in this visualisation, they just keep thinking about the Society of Inner Light's property in Glastonbury, the whole Glastonbury thing, and they're drawn to Glastonbury and they can't put away. So, Dion Fortune was quite happy. This was exactly what the idea was. You wanted the imagery to become interactive. It was a halfway house between the human consciousness and what Dion Fortune could see to be the spiritual forces that she was trying to make contact with, the masters, the angelic realms, whatever. So they started to focus on Glastonbury, and we know that the imagery builds up, but what I immediately found intriguing was in the early part of the war, the first part of the war, literally the first month, September, she starts to get these feelings that maybe something wants to happen. And the very first time they do this is October the 1st. Now, what none of them know, after the campaign in Poland on September the 27th, Hitler had gathered his commanders together and he had surprised the hell out of them by saying, look, we're going to attack France and we're going to do it, I want you to work the whole thing out, we're going to do it now, pretty much now. At that time, he was even thinking of doing it before the end of the year, and they kind of, the whole thinking, they were already, after the Polish campaign, they were pretty much putting some of the equipment they'd used in storage. It's strange looking back, looking at the details, how they were thinking. But the absolute definite decision, we are going to attack France, we are going to attack the West, was made absolutely concretely on September 27th, and it's October the 1st, which is a matter of days later, that Dion Fortune begins this whole process. And it carries on that way. The imagery that we know, the final form of it, you have the inside of the Thule cavern, you have the Rose Cross, and you have kind of spheres, if you like, above and either side of it that correspond broadly to spheres on the Kabbalah, and you've got Christ above, you've got the Virgin Mary beneath, and you've got Arthur and Merlin on either side. One, Arthur is wielding Excalibur and Merlin is holding an orb of sovereignty. But this imagery took months to fully develop. The last bit of it fell into place on April the 21st, 1940. With the Virgin Mary kind of being fully accommodated into all this scheme. It had shunted and shifted. There were all kind of things going on in relation to it, but you can study this in the wartime letters. And what you've effected, this is like literally, the attack on the West starts on May the 10th. This is when Germany attacks the Low Countries and France, and it really gets going. So over this period of what's been called the Phony War, this strange period where nothing much was happening in this country, gradually all this stuff falls into place. And at the same time, Wellesley Tudor Pole, as we know, especially after Dunkirk, I'm not going to go into the details of it in 1940, I'm going to go into the roots of it. He brings out this idea of the silent minute. And this is adopted by the BBC, it's accepted by the government, and there's a moment of a silent tuning every single day during the course of the whole war. And of course, what we know, you know, primarily about Tudor Pole in terms of Glastonbury is his connection with the discovery of the blue glass bowl. And I want to go back to the person who's actually responsible for setting all this in motion, John Goodchild. It's a real, real shame that we don't seem to have, as yet, any photograph of him. I'm not going to tell the whole story, because again, most of you probably know it, and it's already in detail in a number of books, but basically Goodchild, in 1885 in Italy, is told about an interesting item that's been found, bricks up in a wall in a building that's been demolished, a place where there was an early Christian settlement. He gets hold of this, he realises it's quite interesting, but he leaves it with his father, who said, look, you've got to get this checked out. But his father keeps it in a cupboard for 10 years. 10 years go by. And while this is all going on, Goodchild has his own particular obsessions with recovering a high culture that he believed had once existed in Ireland. And it, as far as he was concerned, it was focused on a goddess who had been physically embodied in their high queen, who he called the Mor Rigon, you know, whose name survives familiar probably to all of us here as a figure connected with battlefield dead and their transition to the underworld. As far as Goodchild was concerned, the teaching of the druids, the bards, all derived from her. She was like a living cauldron of plenty. And from this, we've also got the evolution of the figure of Morgan, who plays such a role in the Arthurian stories. And he believed, Goodchild, that this mutates further with the figure of Bride, Bridget, who finds her way into the early church to say there's continuity there with the High Queen. And that this culture was somehow aware of the coming of Christ. The culture was known right across the classical world and even impacted on the writing of the New Testament. That's a bit of a stretch, but all the stuff about the Celtic Church, a whole flavour of things that permeate the Glastonbury airwaves start off with him. Now, once again, yeah, I'm linking ahead a bit here, linking things together, but in terms of Dion Fortune's magic thinking, what occurred to me, you know, we know that as we move into the second half of the 1930s, which are also the years leading up to the war, Dion Fortune becomes increasingly interested in the figure of Morgan, and she creates an idealised magical version of herself, if you like, in the main characters that are in her great novels, the Sea Priestess and Moon Magic. She considers Morgan to be a title that was an initiatory title that ultimately goes all the way back to Atlantis. Now, I am willing to believe that essentially when 1940 kicked in, and again, this is something that doesn't have to have ever been consciously in anybody's head, it doesn't have to have been in her head. She doesn't have to have even read anything that Goodchild ever wrote on this subject. But I think she took on the archetype of the battle goddess of the Morgan, the Morrigan, in order to be able to focus what she did during the magical battle of Britain. And also, you know, I'll say a little bit about the extent to which some of the Nazis were pretty into Atlantis, and there's a whole mythology about that that's behind them as well. The fact that she's got this series, you probably know that she had all kinds of visionary experiences of alleged past lives in Atlantis, that she's embodying a powerful priestess, goddess energy that supposedly goes back to Atlantis, comes in pretty handy at that point. Even though, and this is another thing again, in terms of what they're up against, you'll find in these letters, they obviously know that the Nazis are stirring mythological energies. They obviously know that there are occultists amongst the Nazis, but the details are not known. The kind of characters that I'm going to be talking about, the things that they were into, are not tangibly known to any of the British cultists, really. So we know that the bowl, you know, gets taken to Bride's mouth. It's in, you know, there's a whole book that Goodchild writes called The Light in the West. And while he's at, while the book is at his, the publishers, he tended to travel. He was a doctor and he spent a lot of time in Turin, Italy. He was on his way back and he broke his journey in Paris. He's in a hotel room and suddenly he has this, what's ultimately the most profound experience of his life. He's wide awake when this weird feeling comes over him. It's like he becomes paralysed. And he hears a powerful, disembodied voice giving him quite definite instructions, although he can't recall the exact words afterwards. He's being told, basically, where to take this bowl. It's time to take it to a particular place in Glastonbury, a place known as the Woman's Corner in the vicinity of Bride's Hill. It will pass into the keeping of women. Further instructions will follow. And as the voice kind of signs off, there's this weird rosy light around him. This turns into this oval form, this sparks coming off it, just above his head. And he tries to touch it, it gets like a little electric shock off of it, and then it moves towards the window and disappears. It told him that he had to do this after his father died. And like 2 weeks later, I think it was, his father died. So it's in August 1898 that he takes the bowl and deposits it in what was called Bride's Well, just beneath the water. After that point, he just trusts that somehow it's all going to play out according to divine destiny. He just comes back, you know, once a year, goes there, goes to see whether it's still there, and years go by. Now this is Houston Stewart Chamberlain. In The Rise and Fall of the Third Reich, William L. Shirer said of Chamberlain that he was one of the strangest Englishmen who ever lived. It's probably no exaggeration to say, as I've heard more than one follower of Hitler say, that Chamberlain was the spiritual founder of the Third Reich. You know, he was British. This is the weird thing about it. He had been born the son of an admiral. He'd got a field marshal generals as his uncles. But he'd been given a Prussian teacher as a teenage boy, and it's just turned him into a complete Germanophile until he eventually becomes a German citizen. You know, he met Wagner, became closely associated with the family. Now, here's the interesting thing about Chamberlain. He was, according to this, Shirer talking about, hypersensitive and neurotic, subject to frequent nervous breakdowns. Chamberlain was given to seeing demons who, by his own account, drove him on relentlessly to seek new fields of study, get on with his prodigious writings. One vision after another just told me, you know, shift from biology to botany to the fine arts to music to philosophy. Once in 1896, he was returning from Italy, and the presence of, we'll call it a demon, was so strong that he had to get off the train, shut himself off in a hotel room for 8 days, totally stop what he was doing, and just write. And, you know, when he finished these things, he didn't even recognise it as his own writing. The books he wrote were written in the grip of a terrible fever, a veritable trance, a state of self-induced intoxication. And it was in the grip of precisely one of these states that between April 1st, 1897 and October 31st, 1908, he wrote a 1,200-page long book called Foundations of the 19th Century, which was published in 1899. And this became an absolute sensation. It was hailed as a total masterwork. And Kaiser Wilhelm II pretty much went round, you know, quoting it verbatim, reading out passages of it to anyone that would flip and listen to him, bawling the pants off people by just, you know, saying it was the greatest book ever written. He even 10 years later cornered the British Prime Minister, Herbert Asquith, and basically just kept going on about Chamberlain. And the incredible thing is, you know, decades later he meets up with Hitler as well, and feels that he can go to his grave happy because Germany, in its hour of need, has produced such a man. It's not a crazy, weird, mystical book, although we could say there are crazy, weird, mystical ideas in it. It was all the academics of the time, and when it was translated into English 10 years later, likewise, rapturous reception. But there are particular ideas in there. Jesus, according to Chamberlain, was not a Jew. Jesus was Aryan. You know, now this idea has already been kicking about. Wagner's kind of made a little bit of use of it. But it really takes off. It really takes off. And the whole idea of you know, he says basically that he was of the racial stock of Galilee, and you know, this wasn't Jewish, blah, blah, blah. It sounds very anti-Semitic, it is, but it's, if you, in the course of 1,000 pages, he's not rabid. He does praise the Jews here and there, but looking back on it, you know, there's no question that this is laying some very dodgy foundations indeed. And indeed, yeah, you know, this stuff does not go away. A very quick look on YouTube and you can soon find this sort of stuff kicking about. But what's interesting to me is to place Goodchild and Chamberlain alongside each other during exactly the same period of time. Remember, you know, Chamberlain's writing his book between April 1897 and October 1898. Goodchild is likewise having this weird hotel experience in late 1897. He takes the bowl to Glastonbury in August 1898. Chamberlain was giving his own spin on the early history of Christianity. Goodchild likewise had this whole bunch of weird ideas about the connections between Ireland and the West. He was knocking about in Rome in 1899 trying to find archaeological proof for his theories. Two men experiencing consistent, very strange old states and guidance during the same period of time dealing with the topic of early Christianity. One man lays the foundations for the revival of Glastonbury, the other for the Third Reich. This is also the same period of time you first get glimpse in 1895 in Cornwall of the idea that Jesus came to Britain. That then develops to Glastonbury. So here's WTP, Mr. Tudor Pole. What a character. I love the fact that as a young boy in church, he could see the colours of prayers rising up through the roof. That is just so brilliant. In 1902, when he was 18, he has a dream that he's a monk in Glastonbury Abbey. Comes and visits here. He's living in Weston-super-Mare. The minute he sees the place, it all fits in, he recognises it, and he feels at home, and he gets an immediate feeling something is near at hand, and in particular, the feeling that there's an ancient relic waiting to be found. And he keeps coming back year after year, and soon gets the feeling that he needs to find a triad of maidens who would somehow assist with this holy relic. And he met up with a couple of sisters, Janet and Christine Allen, who were friends of his own sister, Catherine. And so there we are, the Triad of Maidens comes into place. And in November 1905, the Allen sisters make their first visit to Glastonbury, visit the Abbey ruins, fill a whole bunch of atmosphere, stay in some local inn, I'm not sure whether that's the GMP. And Christine Allen starts some automatic writing and soon gets a response from a monk of the Abbey, and they go to Bride's Mound, and Christine sees a vision of a female hands holding up some saucer-like object out of the water. Now remember, when we think of automatic writing and contacting monks in Glastonbury in the first decade of the last century, we always think of Frederick Bride Bond, but this is a couple of years ahead of him, so that's very interesting. And a little bit of time goes by, August 1906. Paul is in his office in Bristol, and there's a weird image almost projected like a film on the wall of what he recognises as the area around Bride's Mound. and the water at a particular area where there's some stones in the thorn tree, and there's this light shining out from underneath. And in the end, his sister Catherine, in October 1906, locates the bowl, and the whole thing has gone full circle. Goodchild is there or thereabouts. He's kind of aware of what's going on, but he's not telling the whole story until it's concluded. And they obviously go into overdrive, and it has to be said that Tudor Pole does stop using the G word. The Grail word was kicked about during that period of time. I guess it's understandable in the circumstances. Everybody that held this object just got blasted by it. There was tremendous force and blessing power with it. Most people were quite clear about that. As it's inevitable that once the news comes out, it does find its way into local press. This is the Daily Express, July 1907. And it's amazing that the tone of all this is quite respectful, I'm sure, now, in the current age, the Solway Sun and so on, that if somebody thought they found a holy grail at Glastonbury, they wouldn't get treated with quite as much kindness. Now, we think of Pole. We know him from this story, we know him from his later work at the Chalice Well. We've probably, many of us, seen the upstairs room. We've maybe been fortunate enough to handle the bluegrass bowl. We think of him as like a fairly staid, pure sort of character. But I, you know, you read into his biography and you realise that actually he's a nutter. And a certain amount of that, you know, nuttiness that we know runs in the family later on with Eddie, was already present there. Because after this story in the Daily Express, psychics, visionaries, they're coming out and they're picking up all this stuff about the Grail. And there's one particular woman who has a pretty strong visionary experience that she communicates to Pole. And he pretty much shares it. He sees the same thing. And it's all about, where did it come from? Where's it been? And they see this vision of what's undoubtedly the final days of the siege of Constantinople in 1453, and they're in the great church of Santa Sophia, and it's quite a dramatic little vision, and it's the last night, and the enemies at the gates, and the next morning it's all busted down, and the place is ruined. And this stays with Tudor Pole, and he starts seeing this within his eyes open, he starts going into one and just keeps on seeing this. He knows that he's got to go off on a quest for this. So in August 1907, he gets on the Orient Express and heads off to Constantinople. And it's pretty dangerous out there at the time. There's a whole political movement agitating against the Solway, the movement that becomes known as the Young Turks. It's on the verge of revolution there. And when he gets there, he follows his intuition, and it's an extraordinary scenario. He's very paranoid, he thinks that spies are everywhere, and it creates a little mood around his adventure. And he's drawn into the vicinity of the former Santa Sophia, now a mosque. And there's a gate in the vicinity, and behind that gate is the Sultan's Harem. This is a private palace where he keeps his Harem. And he believed that he needed to get in there. He just had to get in there because there was something under the ground there, that if he went down there, there was a whole stash of archives and stuff from the early church down there. And he hired out a British guy who spoke Turkish to be his guide and his interpreter. And this guy knew people in the garden and the harem, and they bribed other people. And they got in, and he would kind of go in there and hide behind bushes and look around to see the lay of the land. And he was convinced that one of these visions that he'd seen, that he was there, that some of the details corresponded exactly to his topography, that there was an underground passage, and there was a marble slab that if they got this out of the way, they could go down and everything would be under there. And he actually does manage to sort of get down into this tunnel, and then comes up against another obstacle. But when he gets up, his associate has been basically discovered by these Nubian eunuchs, the Harem guards. And they're really lucky that they get away with it. There are more bribes. They could easily have been arrested. They could have been worse than arrested. I mean, think about it. It's the Sultan, it's like you are literally, it's the equivalent of trespassing in Buckingham Palace and trying to sort of dig down under the ground there. It's a pretty wild undertaking. But he's still, you know, completely convinced. And he hears all these stories when he gets back to Britain that there are contending forces at work. Somebody that also knew this guy, Brian, his associate, worked for the Sultan, who was a British person. She said that the German Kaiser, was working, had got archaeologists that were investigating the same thing, and that whatever the outcome would be, it was profoundly hostile to Christianity. If they found any of these relics, they'd destroy them. Well, that might seem to be a right old low-mole rubbish, but as we say, the nuance of it is very interesting. It goes back in December, and again, you know, I'm saying that he's a nutter, and maybe you think that's a bit unkind, but he goes to the Orient Express wearing a false beard, and his false beard falls off in the restaurant carriage in the soap. And he has to somehow just kind of pretend that everything's all right. He puts the beard back on. He arrives in Constantinople wearing this false beard, and he will only take it off when a psychic voice tells him that he's actually okay to remove it. It's getting more and more difficult politically in the country. He's in the company of some of the revolutionary young Turks. Well, I don't know what he's doing in their company, really, in the garden of an inn. He brings some coffee in, and he's just about to take a sip of the coffee when one of his hosts drinks some and just falls off the chair dead. It's poisoned, you know, so everybody rapidly disperses. And on another occasion, he's going through the street and somebody lurches out of the shadow with a knife and tries to stab him. And the incredible thing is, we see these pictures of Paul at that time. You've got to remember, he's only 23. You know, he's only 23. What a series of adventures for him to already have had at this point. Now, this is a man who will call him what he later came to call himself, Rudolf von Sabotendorf. Ultimately to be head of the notorious Thule Society. Kind of looks halfway between Alistair Crowley and Winston Churchill there, I think. So Bardolph has got real strong links with Turkey. You know, there were a lot of German-Turkish links at that time. He had been immersed in mysticism, and he'd actually been studying with some Jewish family in Turkey and studying with Sufis. He was into Kabbalah, he was into alchemy. And he returned to Turkey in 1908, and a guy that he'd been studying with, an old man, left him this huge esoteric library, and in one of these books was a whole bunch of material, handwritten notes about secret mystical practices of the Biktashi dervishes. It's very, very interesting. Stuff that he gets into. In fact, you can find a British translation of his book, you know, The Islamic Teachings and the Heart of Alchemy. The later book he wrote before Hitler came is his own version of the events that were about to unfold. But he basically is right in there with all of this, and he also says the Young Turk Revolution kick off. They rebel against the Sultan. There's a counter coup back again, but they managed to prevail. It's 1909, it's the end of April. He's seen a whole revolutionary scene played out on the streets right in front of him. There's been a lot of violence, you know, people have been killed, there's been gunfire, the army have been involved. He's seen the whole thing play out, and he's watched it very closely, and I believe that this, you know, had quite an effect on him in terms of how he played it pretty much 10 years after that. We fast forward, we've established the fact that Rudolf von Sabotendorf and Wellesley Tudor Pole are both in Turkey at the same time in the first decade of the last century on mystical quests that are very different. 1916, Svartdos back in Germany, he'd taken Turkish citizenship, and this wasn't very popular with the German authorities. They basically now took it as an excuse for him not to join up and be part of the war. So he goes to see a lawyer on the issue of his contested nationality, and in a random moment of destiny, this guy shows him a newspaper advertisement for an organisation called the Germanen Order, German Order, which was full of this Aryosophical, Aryan, runic, weirdly theosophical stuff. He has a little look through, sees all this stuff about runes and perfect Aryans. Up to this point, he's been hanging out with Jewish people. He doesn't seem to be anti-Semitic, but something goes wrong at this point on. He embraces all of this stuff massively, meets up with the head of this group in Berlin, a guy called Paul, and this is a bloke who is blamed in the racial breeding for the loss of the runic gnosis. And Subotov gets on board with this completely. Same time as this, Tudor Pole, who's already been working as a medium with dead soldiers, helping them over to the light. This is something that he's done pretty much at the moment the First World War breaks out. He feels that he can't hold back any longer from joining up. He'd been exempt from military conscription because his family was responsible for making food stuff that was being used by the army, but he had to join up. And he ended up on the Near Eastern front in what we'll call Palestine. And November the 2nd, the famous Balfour Declaration that sets ultimately in motion the foundation of the State of Israel. And while all this is going on, this is just an account of what happened in 1940. It doesn't matter if you can't really see the writing here, because I'm going to tell you anyway. There's this famous story now, a legendary story, that he's just outside Jerusalem. It's December 1917, they're waiting to see action, and he's talking to this guy that he holds very highly in his esteem, thinks he's a bit of a mystic genius, and this guy says to him, "Look, I'm going to die tomorrow. You know, I know, but you're not. And a greater conflict is coming than the one we've got now. And when it does, the people that have died in this war will be available to help from the other side in that conflict. When that time comes, remember us. We shall long to play our part wherever we may be. Give us the opportunity to do so. For that war for us should be a righteous war. We shall not fight with material weapons then, but we can help you if you will let us do so. We should be an unseen but mighty army. You will still have time available as your servant. Lend us a moment of it each day, and through your silence, give us your opportunity. When those tragic days arrive, do not forget us." Now, admittedly, he's written this conversation down decades later. You know, there's probably a little bit of dramatic license in it, but the essence is there. You know, the essence is there. And indeed, the next day this guy dies, Paul feels spiritual presence is guiding him. He's actually shot by a sniper. Really, pretty nasty wound in his shoulder. He falls to the ground. His sergeant, who's trying to protect him, is shot dead and crunches on top of him, and he's just lying there badly wounded with this dead guy on top of him, and he's kind of thinking, "Well, I wonder how they're going to work this one out, these spiritual presences. How they're going to sort this one out." He's weirdly detached. And he does manage to sort of shuffle through and crawl off. Somebody finds him, he goes to the hospital. It's only a matter of days later that Allenby enters Jerusalem. And this is considered to be a real big deal, a millennial biblical type event. Looking back on it from our perspective now, we would undoubtedly see it otherwise. But, for example, in Glastonbury, the Central Somerset Gazette, December 14th, they had this big headline, a worldwide historical event, Glastonbury special interest. Because there were lots of people for a regiment that had Glastonbury soldiers there. I'd be really interested to find out how many people from Glastonbury actually were entering into Jerusalem with Allenby. Bottendorf is now in Munich towards the end of 1978 at the winter solstice. In other words, just a couple of weeks after this entry into Jerusalem, there is a rededication ceremony in which the local lodge of the Germanic order in Munich, Bottendorf is made the master of that group. And one of the people that he knew was this sculptor who had already founded just this modest little study group called the Thule Society, and they suggested that in order to keep it secret that this was a branch of the Germanic order, maybe they could just call it that. And indeed they did. Wellesley Tudor Pole in February 1918 is appointed the director of occupied enemy territory, and he's immediately engaging with people like Chaim Weizmann, who became the first president of Israel a few decades later. These are the kind of people that Pole is dealing with. Pole is actually involved in the admin for letting the first settlers in to what becomes the state of Israel. He is right there with it. And Israel Seif was Weizmann's personal secretary. He later goes on to become the chairman of Marks and Spencer's. You know, he's quite a big deal in his own right. And he meets up with Pole. And there's a classic account that Seif leaves us in his own autobiography of how Pole was there. Because it's amazing that this guy is given this position of responsibility. This is the guy that's been all over the newspapers for finding the Holy Grail in Glastonbury. This is the guy that talks to dead people and has written a book about helping soldiers over to the light. But the British authorities put him right in the middle of this. And these very, very important people come to see him. And Seif comes round to see Pole, the place that he was living at. Pole says, okay, look, I'll pass that. I've just got to go off to the Western Front. You know, all right then. Pole closes his eyes and just sort of disappears off the planet for a little while, comes back, says, oh, well, we've had, you know, on the Somme front, this is that, we've had a breakthrough over there, this is that, that's that, I think it's going to work out all right. Okay, what's new, Seif? And carry on the conversation. And it turns out that what Pole says, the details of it were really quite startlingly accurate as to what actually it was happening that very day on the Western Front. There are other things that Seif talks about that I haven't got time to go into now, that convinced him that Pole's psychism was spectacularly genuine. So what you've got here is, you know, Pole isn't a British Israelite in the way that we understand that term, but he is right there with a profound connection to the very birth of the State of Israel at the same time that Rudolf von Sobotendorf is right there at the very period of the roots of what becomes the Nazi Party. And I'm just so grateful for having read this book because there is so much information in there that is really, really important. For example, in July 18, Sobotendorf had taken over a Munich newspaper and made it the vehicle of the Thule Society. And ultimately, through who it was sort of sold off to and who got involved in it, this becomes the Volksche Bierbachter, which is essentially the official newspaper of the Nazi Party, but a matter of a few years later. And Sobotendorf would write these articles in there, which were a mixture of Ariosophical mysticism and politics, you know. And the Thule Society, they're movers and shakers. These are not just any old bunch of people. They're able to secure meeting rooms in one of the most lavish hotels in the whole of Germany, the Four Seasons Hotel in Munich. And the place is decorated with swastika flags. They have these ceremonials in there, there's a choir with harmonium accompaniments, and Sobotendorf talks about the psychic use of pendulums. They go off on little outings into the countryside to visit sun castles. It's all pretty charming. But we're now, I've got so much material to give out here, we are now moving towards the point where the Beetle Fire is going to be lit on the tour. Now, as we get into the second half of the material and we talk about my revival of the wartime workers in the 1990s, it all starts on VE Day, 50th anniversary, 1995, where the choir Wayne was in Hyde Park and basically initiated a series of beacon fires being lit all around the country. It was in the midst of that, and I'll tell the story later on this evening, that I first got the idea that this stuff was still alive and kicking and needed to be talked about again. So it seems, because the way these dates have all been set up, I didn't choose this date. I was offered this date as one of a few, I think, and we certainly didn't realise then that this beacon fire lighting was going on. It seems so completely appropriate that it's irresistible to at least have a little sort of 5 minutes or so of like closing our eyes and sort of visualising this, that and the other. So what I'm going to invite you to do, I'll just put a little bit of visual detail in. You don't have to go along with it if you don't want to, but I'm going to just suggest visualising, it's twilight out there, the beacon on the tour, all around the country. We know there's going to be one at St Michael's Mount for you, Michael Layline fans, and just going into the tour and seeing the absolute basics of it, that there's a red road all across the Golden, whatever else you want to do that for any of you, that's absolutely fine. And it's coming up, I made it about a couple of minutes to go to our past eight, so we'll just take it up to there and just a few minutes beyond there, if that's all right with everybody, and we'll just use the candle as the guiding beginning of that. So if you'd all like to close your eyes and see this room as it actually is, us all sitting here, images on the screen, the candle of unity is now coming round, right to the centre of where the just past the screen there. It's on the table to the right of the screen. So imagine that candle, and imagine as you're doing that, that from the candle flame, a light starts to expand very rapidly all around, that fills up this entire room, and it's like an enormous sphere of light expanding out from that candle and going all the way through us, out behind us, out through the walls. We're in the middle of a huge transparent sphere of light, of which the centre is that candle. And we're aware of the fact that out there it's twilight, and with the eyes of our imagination, we very quickly are able to take in the top of Glastonbury Tour and the fact that there are a lot of people up there, and that the full moon that's going to be the Scorpio full moon, is probably on the rise out there, and there is a beacon fire that is about to be lit, and we're also conscious that this is something that is going on in actually 1,000 other places in this country, including ones such as Michael's Mount, that are probably known to us. And we are coming up to 8:30, and I want you to imagine that that beacon fire is bursting into light on top of Glastonbury Tour and simultaneously all around the country. And as that happens, there's obviously a tremendous shift in the mood, in the vibration, in the whole feeling of the magical twilight. It's now briefly as if we can see from far up above, getting ever, ever, ever higher in perspective, that there are points of light just all round the whole of the country. And as if with a blink, we're moving nearer to the tour, and we can see the tower, and we can see the people, we can see the beacon fire, and it's now as if we've passed very rapidly through down the tower, and as if into somehow an internal realm, an enormous cavern inside the tour that is filled with a gentle shimmering light, and hanging in the air in there is a red rose on a cross of gold. And we remember that when this imagery was visualised in 1940, Dion Fortune did not believe it was just for that time, but it was for the future. It was for the regeneration of the national psyche, what she called the new age to come. So feel a little bit of the quality of the unique evening and everything that is occurring, and make your own connections to it in whatever way you will, and you stay with it for just a few moments, and we can bring back whatever from it, and that can stay with us for as long as we want afterwards in the days to come. Wherever you happen to be, with the eyes of your imagination, I'd like you to become aware of that big red rose on the cross of gold inside the tour again. And to pull yourself back up and out away from it. To the awareness of the group on top of the tour, the beacon fire, the magic twilight all around this country. Feel yourself returning with your awareness to an enormous great sphere of transparent light emanating out of a candle in the small town hall. Become aware again of the fact that you're actually physically sitting in that town hall. You can feel yourself sitting on a chair, maybe feel your feet on the floor, aware of your head and your hands and your breathing, and that the light, that enormous great sphere, is returning, shrinking down, coming back through the walls, coming back up through the floor, down from the ceiling, through our bodies, and back to its point of origin in that flame, in the unity candle, which kind of flickers and continues to give out its light. And yeah, we're here in the town hall, engaging with the magical battle of Britain, past and present perspectives. When you're comfortable, once again, open your eyes. Well, we'll maybe have time to go into what anyone may have thought or felt about all of that later on. But we're now going to engage further in the history. There's a lot of detail, still to come. So there's the Thule Society, Four Seasons Hotel. Great grandfather of the German Areosophical mysticism was Guido von Liszt. It was in the last years of his life at this point. He worked out through his own weird system of astrology and runes, stuff that he'd taken from theosophy, incredibly complicated stuff, a series of prophetic ideas. He believed, now remember that what we've talked about, the First World War was dead, and what Wellesley Tudor Pole has said, that they would be available in a future conflict. This is the roots of the silent minute. Well, Liszt believed that the German war dead of the First World War would be somehow reincarnated as what he called a what could be called a collective messianic body, filled with a fierce impetus to a national revolution that would follow and redress all the wrongs of the First World War that was already clearly not working out in Germany's favour. And there were going to be a bunch of dates in the future that were going to be the key years where this would unfold. 1923 and 1932, and in that final year, it's a millennial kind of thing. Essentially, tons of fire are going to come down and possess the entire German nation and inaugurate in, you know, what would be, in his own terms, because he talked about social programs an awful lot, a totalitarian new age. Now, we'll get on to 1923. That was all of a key year in the rise of the Nazis. 1932, they came to power in January 1933. 1932 is near enough as far as I'm concerned. I'm willing to believe that Liszt has somehow plugged in there and he's got something genuine. And it fits, I think, very interestingly, alongside Tudor Pole and his own experiences at the same time. It's at the end of October 1918, so that's almost at the end of the First World War, that there's talk of founding a kind of political workers' circle, which is a branch of the Thule Society, because quite a lot of these people are aristocrats, they're rich, they want to influence the workers. There had been, in the very beginning of November, and this is now literally days before the end of the First World War, a revolutionary uprising in Munich, led by a guy called Kurt Eisner, who was a Jewish theatre critic, you know, as well as spent some time in prison. The red flag was raised all over the city, and on November the 9th, Subotendorf addressed the Thule Society. I assure you and swear by this holy sign, and it's talking about the swastika, with the victorious sun as my witness, that I will remain loyal. Trust me as you have trusted me thus far. Our difficult struggle will be on two fronts, the inner and the outer. The outer requiring us to fight everything un-German. Our order is a Germanic order. Never will the mind of a lower race understand us. And so on and so forth. The eagle is a symbol of the Aryan. Now, my brothers and sisters, it's no longer the time for beautiful speeches and festivities. Now is the time to fight, and I shall fight until the swastika rises victoriously at the end of this winter. And almost immediately, they put an edition out of their newspaper blaming the war on international Jewry, international masonry, international capitalism. And he immediately works out, on November the 10th, a whole new strategy. They're going to found essentially a paramilitary wing. In Germany, after the First World War, there's a whole bunch of groups called Free Corps. They're made up from people that are soldiers that have come back from the front. Anybody that is up for a bit of severe mischief, basically. And these guys, the Thule group, are perhaps the first Free Corps in Germany. And they start organising things very, very quickly. The rooms and the hotels start getting filled up with guns, weapons, as well as all the esoteric lectures and stuff about pendulums. They start piling weapons. And very early on in 1919, this idea of the German Workers' Party, a group is founded that has come directly out of the Thule Society. And at the same time, January 1919, Tudor Pole has been promoted to a major, and he is really heavily involved in the secular administration in Palestine. This is Kurt Eisner, who's the guy that's taken control of this revolutionary uprising. And this is where Thule gets really, really directly involved in the tangible history of that period, because they won't let anybody in with a Jewish background. And there was a guy who had been a soldier, he was a decorated officer, but they'd refused to admit because he was Jewish. He wanted to prove his German credibility, so he murdered this Kurt Eisner. And this was a huge event at this point. You know, Eisner becomes a bit of a martyr. It's news that's all around the world, all across Germany, you're getting these little uprisings and things going on. It's getting very, very chaotic. And months of chaos follow in Munich. There's a Bavarian Soviet Republic proclaimed by a total ragtag bag of eccentrics. You know, the guy who's in charge is a poet called Ernest Toller. He's, you know, he's heavy into the political rhetoric, but he's been a poet and a playwright. And the guys they put together, you know, the Minister for War had been a waiter in a restaurant. There was a car mechanic takes charge of the transport ministry. They now open up university to anyone, regardless of their education. There was a guy called Franz Lipp, who becomes the People's Deputy for Foreign Affairs, based on the fact that he owned a decent coat and had a good beard. And he requested foreign aid from Switzerland, and when they refuse, he officially declares war on them on behalf of, you know, the Bavarian Soviet Republic. So Toller's taking control of all of this. It's flipping preposterous, and you can kind of understand why the characters of the Thule Society are getting more and more angry about it. And so are the German Communist Party. And before long, they send in, you know, some real hardcore types. You know, there's another uprising in April. still the communists are undefeated, and some people that have literally been involved in the Russian Revolution, some people that have seen a lot of real bloodshed, they get involved in Bavaria, they take over, and it's like, okay, we're requisitioning all the money from all the rich people, we're putting it in, you know, anyone that's out after certain hours would get shot dead, and it's getting a bit flipping grim. It's like hardcore Leninists working the Russian model in a German city, so people are obviously getting a bit fed up. And then the good luck that had been protecting the Thule Society at their hotel evaporates. The authorities knew about them. They knew about them, but now the communist revolutionists find out. They search the place thoroughly, they find out what's really going on, and seven members of the Thule Society are arrested. And the guy on the right, Prince von Thurn und Taxis, was heir to the wealthiest family in Bavaria. This is a guy that has grown up in a 500-room castle and another dozen palaces. It's quite a big deal. The woman, the Countess von Westarp, she was actually the secretary of the Thule Society. So this little group was like a microcosm of Thule diversity. And on April 30th, 1919, seven of them were taken to a gymnasium and just shot dead out of hand. It was already clear that this revolutionary Soviet thing wasn't going to work. There was a massive force of over 20,000 Free Corps outside Munich. Once this murder has occurred, this is news around the world, this is in American newspapers, this is a big story. The Free Corps steam in. Now, I don't know if you can say, with that imagery, you're already seeing, on the left, there's a swastika on that van. And on the right, skull and crossbones. So there's a little prefiguration, or, you know, there's a little bit of a style template going on there. Now, from my, you know, oh yeah, also the Bavarian Free Corps all coming in their traditional uniforms, marching into Munich. There's quite a bit of carnage on the street, artillery, tanks on the streets of Munich. The communists are completely routed ultimately. Now, what I find very interesting, I'm not in any doubt about the fact that this is the event that essentially begins the Nazi story. And it happens on, you know, Fort Purgis Nat, April the 30th. We call it Beltane, but it's got a lot more pokey associations in Europe than what it has over here. And the thing that I find intriguing is that the Nazi story is essentially bookended by murders, suicides, sacrificial rites on Beltane, because it's in 1945. You know, it's an unfortunate thing that the most famous Beltane wedding happens to be Hitler and Eva Braun, but that is the case. And of course, they killed themselves straight afterwards. The Nazi story ends on April the 30th, 1945. And in my opinion, really, it's these events around the Thule Society in April 1919, in particular the deaths of these seven members, which becomes a whole big, you know, emotional martyrology that marks something very strange that starts off there. And what's really intriguing is that this massive period of time, Hitler's about in all this, somewhere or another, this incredibly important period of time, in fact, a period of months, is covered by one page in Hitler's Mein Kampf. And Ian Kershaw is one of Hitler's most important recent biographers, recognises this is very, you know, interesting. And it's in September 1919 that he joins the German Workers' Party, which is one of Thule's political projects. And he says in Mein Kampf that he was on an assignment to spy on the group for the army. But it really does seem like quite possibly he was paid by the army to join and given funds to get involved and make something out of it. And it's also the case that although the meeting that he discusses that he went to the beer hall, the group was also gathering in the Four Seasons Hotel. Now, although Thule are not meeting in it as much as they had been in the few months before, there's no way that he doesn't know about all of these associations. No way. It's in June 1920 that things pick up in Glastonbury. As Paul Ashton's shown in his book, there's a very interesting sermon preached in St John's Church on June the 24th, where a visiting dignitary, Canon of Gloucester, starts talking about Glastonbury is beyond time as history knows it. You know, it has neither beginning of days nor end of life, and he likens it somehow to the biblical character Melchizedek, as he likens Glastonbury to Melchizedek, and Paul Ashton wonders, because Dion Fortune was about in Glastonbury here and there during that period of time, whether she heard that, and whether her own connections with Melchizedek perhaps set up there. And a couple of days later, the local vicar started talking about the idea that, well, why shouldn't Jesus have come here? I feel perfectly happy with that idea. I'm willing to accept that. So this is the first time that Paul Ashton's managed to find a definite indication of this story being talked about in Glastonbury. And through the 1920s and into the 30s, that develops more and more. Lionel Smith Lewis gets on the case in the 20s and starts to put out this idea. First of all, it's a little pamphlet, and then it gets expanded into a book, and then it gets expanded into a bigger book. Until during that period of time, people are pretty much accepting that Jesus came to Glastonbury. Indeed, obviously, there are many people that still believe that now. Now, it's very interesting to dip into the inner world of Wellesley Tudor Pole during this period of time, because Pole had been very idealistic about the First World War. You know, he felt that there was tremendous spiritual forces were guiding and guarding us to ultimately a victorious outcome, and that in certain institutions such as the founding of the League of Nations, there was great hope for the human race. But at the end of 1920, he writes to his sister, certain powers using material from human passions and selfishness that succeeded in drawing down a curtain between us here in our world and our spiritual horizons. In other words, the aerial Armageddon has broken out again. You know, that all of the horrors of the war, all the emotions, all of the death and all the rest of it, the darker forces were making use of that at that point. And with hindsight, I certainly have to wonder whether or not this period of time is seeing undoubtedly the matrix of the Nazi Party is part of this drama. A few years later, he writes to a friend of his, and he pinpoints the spring of 1919. In other words, the time of all this tumult in Germany, and that leads ultimately to this whole business around Paul Ferguson Act and the seven members of the Thule Society being killed and the Communist Revolution being trashed and so on. Spring 1919 is when things start going wrong. In the area that he called, in his own terminology, the borderland, the area of the interface between spiritual forces and humanity, something had gone wrong. He had once believed that the Second Coming was imminent. You know, as Rudolf Steiner believed in the coming of the etheric Christ, as he talked of it. But now, something has got in the way. Something was forestalling it. And talking of Steiner, it's absolutely extraordinary that in May 1922, he actually gets booked to give a lecture at the Four Seasons Hotel. You know, typical Steiner-type anthroposophical subject. And I can't believe that he didn't know what that place was. It was known. I can't believe that the people around him didn't know. And the result ends up in newspapers in New York. Of course, it turns into a punch-up. You know, people that are part of the early Nazi Party disrupt it. There's all kinds of... It turns into a fist fight. Now, Steiner, it's really hard to get a grip on this because it was... It was reported that he was giving a lecture to a bunch of women and long-haired theosophists. So when your early Nazi thugs come in looking for a punch-up, has Steiner got some security? You don't really think of it that way, do you? You don't think that Steiner's got some muscle with him and that anybody that gives him a bit of travel is going to get a kick in. It's very difficult to work out what happened, but somehow started to fly without having had a kick in. And you know, Thule holds its own turf, as it were. But it's very, very strange, isn't it? Dion Fortune has made her own connection now. She's in Glastonbury. Her psychism is starting to operate. She's already worked with Frederick Brightbourne, and she's made the connections with the company of Avalon, and she's starting to build up her estate. And in August of that year, 1922, she has she connects up with the company of Avalon, and she has a vision, and she gets a message. We're met here together for the downpouring of the power. The chalice is above the tour. This is the hour of the power of the chalice. Those who look to see it as a crystal cup, through which shows the ruby of the blood sailing across the night sky above the tower. Let all look who can see the vision, for now again there is power as of old time, and that power is upon us. So that's, you know, the iconography of that image that I commissioned Yuri to make. That's one of the reasons why I've got that chalice there. This is 1922. And remember that 1923 is Guido von Liszt's Tongues of Fire prophetic year. Rudolf Steiner was a great visionary, a great psychic, but I don't think you've got to be a great psychic to know that if you build a huge, great building made out of wood, that you are possibly going to run into one or two obvious little difficulties. And this is the original Gurfein, an amazing building in terms of what it was and its design and everything that went into it. And on New Year's Eve 1922, it is burnt to the ground. If you read The Spear of Destiny, it's confidently stated that it was arson from the Nazis. I don't really think so. There are some good accounts of how this whole thing started. It was probably some faulty wiring beyond the wall. It is weird that Steiner had given a lecture about spiritual fire the very night that this thing broke out. But, you know, there we have it. At the same time, the beginnings of Dion Fortune's secret doctrine, she started to get contacts. She starts writing this book in July 1923. Not the easiest of Dion Fortune's books to get into. The metaphysics of it, the cosmology, if you like. Many people that have been into it for years read loads of her books and totally got into them. When they come up against this, they can only get so far with it. I likewise can only get so far with it, but it's a very important moment in her development. There's no question about that. But it starts off and then they stop. You know, they have a little bit of time where they start writing and then they stop. And this is when things get very big in Germany, because Hitler in Munich leads this revolutionary uprising called the Munich Putsch, which he thinks is going to result in an uprising across the whole of Germany. On one level, it's a catastrophic failure. I don't know, you probably can't really see that image on that one. There's a 23-year-old Heinrich Himmler in all of that there, getting himself involved in the proceedings. The thing degenerates into a farce, a few people are killed. Dion Fortune starts work again in December 1923 on the cosmic doctrine. Well, Hitler is awaiting trial, you know, for treason and insurrection and all the rest of it. It's now 1 year on from the Gurfein and burning down, and Steiner convenes a Christmas conference at Dornach. They're getting ready to lay a foundation stone for the creation of the second Gurfein. And he announces a new kind of foundation, a new group, the General Anthroposophical Society. And he is now going to be directly involved in it in a way that technically he hadn't been before. And if you get involved in anthroposophical literature, you look at where they're at, they consider this Christmas conference to be perhaps the most important event of the 20th century. Now, being as the 20th century sees two world wars, atom bombs, DNA, you know, space travel, that's kind of pretty extraordinary, I think, that way. It's a turning point in spiritual history as far as they're concerned. And the new Michaelic mysteries are fully engaged. Steiner believed in an idea that had been talking about for a while, that different periods of time are presided over by different archangels, and that the epoch of the Archangel Michael began in 1879, and that the whole of his life and his work and the work of anthroposophy is intimately connected to this. And they laid a foundation stone on New Year's Day 1924. And it's also worth mentioning, when we talk about anthroposophy, that this is not just a title, and this is something that you can actually read about Steiner for years and never even get to this, that anthroposophia is a living spiritual being. It is essentially the Sophia that we know, the divine wisdom. And at this point, you know, the world is literally permeated by Sophia, and a whole new mystery school cycle is initiated. So this is a massive thing for Steiner. It's a massive thing also that's going on with Dion Fortune. And Hitler, you know, here's the new Gurtheum, which endures to this day, thankfully, an absolutely awesome building. Hitler is in Landsberg prison and decides that he, after being a bit discouraged, that he will turn it all around, because he's got a real cushy number in there. The judge at his trial has just let him say whatever he wants. At one point, the judge actually lets Hitler talk for 4 hours. And it's getting a bit crazy, because after they've shipped him off to prison, there is a cult of women who are sort of in love with Hitler, and they literally ask the court authorities if they can take a bath in the same bathtub that Hitler had a bath. Yuck. They turn them down. It's about the only bit of sanity flowers and all the rest of it. It realises that he can turn this around. He writes Mein Kampf, and he leaves prison in an epic fashion file on December the 20th, 1924. And it seems to be the same period of time that Dion Fortune finally encounters Melchizedek. So, and shortly after that, February 1925, the Cosmic Doctrine is finished. March the 30th, 1925, Rudolf Steiner dies. July 1925, the first bit of Mein Kampf is published. Now, just to throw a bit of weirdness into the works and to show that things aren't so clear cut, it is worth noting that Wellesley Tudor Pole spent a bit of time in Italy during the 1920s, and he actually saw Mussolini speaking from a balcony. And he actually thought that Mussolini was kind of all right, you know, and he sort of thought, yeah, all right, he's going a bit fast here, he could burn himself out a bit, but I think he's a good bloke, and he seems to be doing all right. So, you know, the perspective that one has afterwards, you know. We're jumping ahead now. This, you probably recognise, is Wavelsburg Castle, you know, Heinrich Himmler's Black Camelot. It's not coming up very well. That's a kind of enormous, like, building plan. Just like Albert Speer and Hitler concocted this enormous building plan for Berlin after the war was over. So Himmler had got great plans for Wavelsburg. And there's kind of like, the castle forms the point of what looks like a spear. And Himmler did have a copy of the Spear of Destiny on his desk. You can see it a bit more clearly there. And there's a kind of computer graphic, I don't know where that's coming out there on the next screen, of what they were hoping to accomplish at Wavelsburg. They didn't get very far with it. But what they did do, they had lavish looking resources, you know, more than anybody could ever hope for in Glastonbury, that's for sure. Yeah, on this ceremony at the castle, there's nice little interior, there's SS weddings going on there. All of the rooms, the finest wood, the finest fittings, the finest material, absolutely no expense spared whatsoever in this. At the end of the war, the picture on the left, Easter 1945, a bunch of SS men try and completely destroy the place, but they haven't got enough explosives, so it's kind of wrecked, but it's able to be restored. It's a youth hostel and a museum now. But the guy that is most associated from our point of view with all of this is Carl Maria Vinegar. And that book there by Stephen Flowers and Moynihan, Secret Key, that is a great, credible book about Vinegar and about the kind of material that his mystical, strange mind came up with. Vinegar has been called, there's a French book about it that calls him Himmler's Rasputin. And I've chosen that picture of Himmler because that is a picture which I think really does capture the coldness and the mercilessness of the bloke. You know, there are other photos where he just looks a bit blank. But in that one, I think you can feel most certainly that he's a nasty piece of work. Vinegar has been for the First World War, risen through the ranks, he was a major, decorated for bravery, great soldier, all the rest of it. But he had on this claim that his father, as heir to this vast heritage of ancestral wisdom, and this goes on to him. Vinegar claims to be the final descendant of this ancient line of German adepts. He's ultimately descended from the god Thor, and in more recent times from the hero Arminius, who defeated the Roman legions. And paranormal visionary powers are passed down through the bloodline, enabling him to have this perfect ancestral memory. You know, the Atlanteans had colonised Germany 200,000 years ago, and the whole New Testament story had actually happened in Germany. You know, this is a weird kind of bearing on the British Israelite, all Latin and Edinburgh type versions of reality. And that there was a figure called Christ that was the origin of Christ, and he had founded a religion called the Urbanist religion in 12,500 BC. And this was the knowledge that was passed down through the Vinegut family. Now, in 1924, Vinegut's wife had actually got him put in a mental asylum where he stayed for 3 years. You know, there's literally a scene where he's eating at a cafe with some mates, and this ambulance pulls up, these guys just pour out and bundle him into this van and lock him up. He has, you know, as well as all this strange ideas, he's a bit of an alcoholic. He gets into real mood swings, walks around with a loaded revolver, threatens to kill his wife. But he gets out, and in September 1933, he meets Himmler for the first time. And in November 1933, Himmler goes to Babelsberg for the first time. And he becomes part of Himmler's personal staff. He's not part of the famous Ahnenerd, the Ancestral Heritages Division. He is part of Himmler's personal staff. And he totally sets a style template for Wavensburg. You've probably seen things like these SS Totenkopf rings, they're quite famous. He designed all of that. There's a whole wheel of the year, there's a whole series of ceremonies, like SS weddings and how you celebrate the summer solstice, how you celebrate the winter solstice, the whole bunch of runic stuff. It's all come from him. It has all come from him. And these SS rings, you know, people are flipping, making new versions of this stuff. You know, you can buy this stuff. I found this, and there's all these customers saying, yeah, great seller, yeah, buy with confidence from this guy if you want your flipping SS rings, mate. Down in the bottom of the castle, there's this famous image, which has now become called the Black Sun. Whether or not it's got any esoteric background, even in the Nazi period, in the way that it has come to have in the modern world, is very, very difficult to say. It's been adopted on a world cosmic level as an icon of a whole gnosis of neo-Nazi occultism, should we say. And yeah, you can get your black sun coffee mug, or if you want your stainless steel travel coffee mug, black sun, you can get that. And I've seen some watches, but I miss watches, but I couldn't find an image of that. Of course, now your Blackstone cross. I've got to say this one to crack me up, because a lot of people say, oh yeah, brilliant, when it first came out, blah, 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 space aliens. But it came out on the 8th of the 8th, the 8th of August, 8-8. Now, 8-8 is a known neo-Nazi bit of coded, because the 8th letter of the alphabet is the letter H. H-H, Heil Hitler. This has been widely in use for decades. So the fact that this turned up, got the 8th for the 8th, very strange, more than a little bit dubious, in my opinion. There's a guy, the architect, who was in charge of all the restoration work on the castle, because he was a bit knackered when he got hold of it. Totally let Willard Villiger do whatever the hell he wanted. Now, one, I wish there was a photo of this, there probably is, but I haven't been able to find it. There's a very big book about Babelsberg that cost you more than 100 quid to get hold of, that's full of photos. Maybe there's a photo in there. But there's a glow room, okay? And it's positively new age in its ambience, because what they've got in there is a huge rock crystal displayed on a pedestal that is lit below by electric light. You know, this is something that you could go and find. No one's probably got something like that in Stone Age at the moment. It may reflect the depiction in Wolfram von Eschenbach's Parzival of the Grail as a green stone crystal, or it might do. It's actually Villiger that has introduced Otto Rahn to Hitler. That's very, very faithful. I'm not going to go into too much detail about all that. Many of you probably heard of Otto Rahn. It's Villiger that sort of, you know, leads him on his fateful journey. And within the matrix of Babelsberg, as I say, he is propounding a whole cosmology, this sort of stuff about Atlantis, blah, blah, blah. So this sits very interestingly alongside Dion Fortune and her Atlantean background, her memories, what she makes of it, what she thinks of it, what kind of power she's packing. Now here's where it gets, I think, very intriguing. Because Villiger has got his enemies in the SS. There are people, it's the whole thing that he's been in a mental institution has been kept secret, but he's drinking, he's getting a bit crazy. August 28th, 1939, he is retired from his SS position. August the 28th, that's just a couple of days away from the start of the Second World War. You know, he's basically taken out of commission. The magical engine of Babelsberg, if you like, which had the potential to be flipping formidable, was, you know, powered down at the very point that it could have been really powered up. You know, the magus of Babelsberg was absent from Babelsberg totally during the time of the magical Battle of Britain. In fact, there's very, you'll hear all these stories all over the internet about what went on in Babelsberg, human sacrifice, and blah, blah, blah. There's nothing credible to suggest that it was a work in progress that was never finished. But what we can say, and this is the chilling legacy of Himmler's Black Camelot, is that literally just before the invasion of Russia in 1941, there's a gathering of top SS people there. We know Reinhard Heydrich, who has a terrible, terrible reputation as one of the prime architects of the Holocaust, spent time there. But yeah, he, Himmler, a whole bunch of people had a conference at Babelsberg where they discussed what they were going to do in Russia, how they were going to conduct themselves. And we've got records on it, and they're quite accepting of the fact that maybe up to 20 million people will die. That's just how it goes. If we're going to get what we want, then like, so be it. So that is pretty chilly. Although you haven't got, you know, the Dennis Wheatley occult bunch of people in black robes all standing around and demons and blah, 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 you've nonetheless got something, a situation where you have an official writing off of 20 million people that actually carries forward into reality, because that's essentially what really happens. So while this is going on, while Babelsberg's been set in motion during the mid to late 30s, this causes the time that Dion Fortune is singing the praises of Glastonbury, all the aspects of its mythology. She's coming up with the Mystic Kabbalah, which is you know, there in the background of the actual imagery that's used finally in the 1940 workings. And here's a bit of symmetry that I find really interesting. Because Dion Fortune and Colmrea Villigut died within a couple of days of each other in 1946. Villigut died on January the 3rd. Dion Fortune died on January the 8th. Although they were born in different years, she was born on December the 6th, he was born on December the 10th. I just tend to see that as a weird symmetry that suggests in some way that there is on another level of perception a linking of the karma, the destiny, and the roles that were played of these two people, you know, and that, remember, nobody knew about Wavensburg. British intelligence didn't really seem to have anything on it. You know, during that whole period of time, nobody really knows that Himmler's got a Grau castle, and yet all of this is somehow playing out on another level of the game. And this is my fascination, you know, this is, it's always been my fascination. And in 1995, I'd already read an awful lot about Nazi cultism. I'd already read about the magic of Battle of Britain. We had a whole scenario that a big thing was going to go on the 50th anniversary of V-Day. And I got up that morning, and as was my habit at the time, pulled a tarot card for the day. And I got the lightning struck tarot, and I thought, what kind of day is it going to turn into if I've got that little bit of trepidation? You know, it's going to be an interesting day if I've got the lightning struck tower. So I turn on the telly later on, early afternoon, and there's enormous crowds in front of Buckingham Palace and the rest of it. Vera Lynn comes out on the stage, obviously sings "We'll Meet Again," all the rest of it. Respect to Vera Lynn. She is a class act. Of course she was there. But what is this that starts happening? Who is this appearing on the stage now? The Queen Mother's appeared on the balcony, she's on her own. It's Cliff Richard. Cliff Richard, we know he's old, but he wasn't in the Second World War, was he? Okay. Cliff Richard starts to sing congratulations to the Queen Mother. I have cognitive dissonance of some kind. I'm sort of slightly sick in my mouth, and I turn the TV off. And I think this is not good enough. This not fulfilled the day for me. Now at that time, I didn't have my own copy of Avalon of the Heart, but I had a copy from Southend Library. It was the one with this cover, the Janet Colin Baldwin photograph. And it was on the floor. On the floor by some CDs. And it was slightly overcast. Now this is absolutely no word of a lie. This is exactly what happened. The sun came out, and a shaft of light came through the window, went across the floor, and pretty much just landed on the cover of Avalon of the Heart. And instantly, I knew what I was going to do. I knew that that night there was going to be beacon fires lit all around the country. That there was a particular time, there was going to be 2 minutes silence, and then there was going to be beacon fires lit. During that 2 minute silence, I would try and go back into the Dion Fortune wartime imagery. I would try and go inside the tour and imagine Arthur, Merlin, whatever, and just the tremendous emotion that was there that day, because in terms of how old people were, this was probably the last time that many people of that generation that had been involved in the war would be able to be present for this. I mean, they carried on doing this stuff, but obviously the numbers just diminished and diminished. There were still quite a few people there. I could feel the emotion of it. I absolutely could. And so the time came, you know, and I have this sense of I close my eyes during the 2 minute silence and feel this overwhelming emotion. I was practically crying, and it's not like I saw anything in particular, but there was a sense of connectedness. There was a sense, because I guess because my family were involved in the Second World War and because I know so much history anyway, but it helped me to really become emotionally charged up. So the 2 minute silence, it's over, and I turn on the TV, and something's happening that I had not got the faintest idea was going to happen. The Queen is in Hyde Park, and she is at some console, and when she kind of activates it, a laser beam fires out of it across to the GPO tower, and a whole load of lights spiral up the top of it, and then fireworks blast out the top. And then I thought, well, okay, that'll do for the lightning struck tower for the day, thanks very much. I'll call that a result. So one of the things that I've done when I first had this idea, this is before the internet, this is before social media. If this happened now, you'd stick that up on Facebook and you could get a whole bunch of people interested in it very quickly. That, but this is the old ancient epoch telephone. So I just rang round trying to find people I knew I thought might be up for it. And about half a dozen people said, yeah, well, I will do that as well. And I was very interested to get the feedback coming back. You know, anybody said it was a vibe you love it. There was one particular account that I thought absolutely made my day. And that was a female friend of mine, this round here actually, in the Froome area at the time. She was quite big on the Mist of Avalon novel, visionary journeys, the tour as priestess and all that, easy peasy for her. So she got into this. I'm using this image model of Tobias as half of the Brits because it's about the nearest book we can get to it. But she goes, finds herself in the tour, and there, she knows who it is, although he kicks himself, there, stark bollock naked, is Arthur Pendragon, sporting a massive erection. She goes over to him, all right, mate, and at this point, light just shines out everywhere, electricity just goes across the entire country, and it's like, cool, the crops will thrive this year. And this to me was brilliant because this took us beyond this staid Victorian gentleman portrayed by Alfred Lord Tennyson. A lot of the, you know, the portrayals of this, you know, Christian monarch King Arthur, this took us back to this raw archetype, this power that is like, you know, of the land itself and the ancestors. I tend to think of Arthur now, whatever he's been in the past, whatever the history of the evolution of the idea of the archetype is, as the Lord of the Dead, like Cyrus, all of the dead, you know, from the Stone Age, from the people that built West Kent, Long Barrow and Avebury, right up to the War Dead, right up to the people who died in the First World War, the Second World War, all the ancestors, the whole lot of them, Arthur is Lord of the Dead. He can function. In that way. So the fact that in this raw, primal way that was not mediated by any of the traditional archetypes, as I say, the Stead Victorian gentleman, he was there and he was vibrantly powerful. That just said to me that Dion Fortune was right. She was strangely confident in 1940. Before the Battle of Britain was even physically played out, she thinks it's already a done deal. We've won, and what all this is about now is the regeneration in the future. So I go on from there, I move here in 1995, and I start to get ideas. You know, the work is in 1940, we've essentially got people that know the Kabbalah, the Rose Cross in the middle is Tifereth, and then you've got Christ above, Virgin Mary below, Arthur and Merlin. You've got a few spheres that aren't there. And I was working in a factory at the time, working in Imco Plastics, and I just started getting this imagery that seemed to form a Glastonbury Kabbalah. And I presented this in public in Glastonbury on Dion Fortune's birthday in 1996 as a public path working. And people got well into it. And it's there, in its broad day, I was in my first book, The Steer of Artorias. And from that point on, periodically, this stuff just keeps coming back. You know, when Princess Diana died in 1997 and there was all this mythic stuff going on, it seemed clear that the archetypes were stirring. In the week leading up to her funeral, the details of where she's going to be buried on this island in a lake come out, and newspaper headlines, "The Lady of the Lake." And what I thought was really fascinating about that was people were saying they were quite happy to think of Prince William becoming king, but I do like the idea of Charles becoming king, because he was, you know, they felt him to be her son. They didn't really think of him as being Charles's son. They thought of Diana and William, and that it was her that somehow gave him that credibility. And so what that meant to me, as somebody that's, you know, read a lot of stuff about the Arthurian mysteries, she was being seen as the bestower of sovereignty, which is a very ancient archetypal thing. You know, Katie Matthews wrote a book about Arthur and the sovereignty of Britain. I think it's come out under a different title now. But it's not the kind of thing that's on most people's lips. It's not the kind of subject that most people are talking about. But it's really deep archetype and stirred. So the night before the funeral, a few of us got together in the Bridget Centre and imagined enormous angels with flaming swords standing guard around London for where the funeral service was going to be. And then the next night, on the night of the funeral, a few of us gathered in what was then the Library of Avalon. And again, in the days coming up, some imagery came to me, and I mutated the Arthur and Merlin images, so that we're in Westminster Abbey and there's all this kind of golden red sunlight filling the whole place up, and Arthur himself is sitting on the throne above the stone of Sovereignty, and William is brought to him and he's got the sword Excalibur and he knights him, and you've got a group setting, like almost a group photo of the royal family outside Windsor Castle, and the grounds of Windsor Castle are associated with Herne the Hunter, the archetype of the horned god. Merlin himself has a very strong association with the horned god. So a giant Merlin horned god figure, you know, holding an orb of sovereignty, comes and stands behind this group and radiates power around it. And it all seemed pretty damn funky. So I convey to you, you know, the idea that these images, the whole thing, the whole 1940 working, it's not just a historical relic, it's something that's alive and kicking, it has voltage, and you can connect with it now, you can have your own inspirations. And the roots of it are gigantic. You know, what I've talked to you about with Tudor Pole, the Thule Society, and Babelsberg, and Colbury, and Vinegar, and Houston, Stewart Chamberlain, and John Goodchild, there's loads more. There's absolutely loads more. I've got hundreds of pages of stuff written down that I've been working on since 2010 now. I do hope that I bring it to completion soon. But every time I really get stuck into it, you know, the intensity of it, the weirdness that erupts around me is quite powerful. You know, this is strong stuff. But I'm really very chuffed that a night like this, it's all come together in this way, that somehow or another I'm putting this material out on a night when so much is going on around the country. It's another one of those nights. I've got a few copies of the Steel Martyrs. It's only a fiver now. Glastonbury Kabbalah is in there. No small size, but yay.